Lord, I believe all things are possible. God bless your bones, America. I'm your host, the Right Reverend David Clark, and I'm more than happy to come into your home today and to declare the blessings of God in your life. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the blessings of God maketh rich and addeth no sorrow. Today, we're going to hear the voice of my special guest, John Fletcher. John came out of the drug culture, but now he's a brand new creature, and he's going to share his experience with us. But not only that, he is an author, he's a writer, he's a poet, and a playwright, and he's going to share that experience with us. So we have a wonderful, excuse me, so we have a wonderful show today, and I want you to call your neighbor, to call your friend, and let them know that the Across the Pastor's Desk broadcast is now on the air. Welcome to Across the Pastor's Desk.
Thank you, Reverend. You know, I remember growing up listening to Across the Pastor's Desk on the radio. And a lot of people may not know, but we grew up together as children. And we both took different paths, though. My path went in the path of sin and doing the things that were destructive in my life. I was a gangster. I was a thug. I was a dope fiend. Ultimately, I was a sinner, you know, and as you say, God is good. The word tells us, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts in him. And today, I trust wholeheartedly in the Lord Jesus Christ because he has a purpose and a will for my life today. I don't have to be like a man without any boundaries. The word tells us, don't let your spirit be like a city without any walls. And today I don't have to be that way. You know, I have a purpose in life today, and that's to serve the Lord Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
Beautiful, beautiful. You know, there's a drug problem in the world, in the United States, and especially in the Pittsburgh area.
Yes, indeed.
You know, you're right. We took different paths, and I remember sitting at the table eating food, and I looked on the television. I mean, I hadn't seen you in years.
Yes.
I looked on the television, and I saw John Fletcher arrested.
Yes.
I saw the police pull you out of the house.
Yes.
I saw your hands cuffed. Mm-hmm. Yes. I could not believe my eyes.
Yeah. Shackled,
I thought you were somewhere in somebody else's church.
Yeah, in the devil's church.
And so when I saw you, my heart went out. I felt so bad. I was saying, Lord, I know that brother. What is he doing in the dope house?
Yeah.
You know,
yes,
and you had really gotten involved in a drug culture to the point where you were manufacturing marijuana. You were manufacturing cocaine.
Yes.
You were manufacturing heroin.
For distribution. Yes. Yes.
And what did they arrest you for that day?
Well,
I mean, there were so many things going on.
Actually, you said it: manufacturing crack cocaine and heroin. I mean, we had a dope house. We had prostitution going on. We had money laundering going on. you know, there were a number of things that we were doing illegally. You know, it's sin is sin, and the devil don't care who he attacks, you know. And I'm just grateful today that God has made my life different. He's taken a crooked stick and he's drawn a straight line with me today. And I'm, you know, grateful to have the opportunity to tell people that because your circumstances haven't changed, you can change. God can change you today. God can make you a different person. There's hope. If you have faith in Jesus Christ and believe in Jesus with all your heart, that God can make a difference in your life today.
Now, we had communion together. We was in the choir together.
Yes.
We were in Sunday school together.
Yes, yes, all that.
What traumatic experience happened to you that that caused you to go in that direction?
Well, my life experiences, one of them, being in the church, there was a family member who happened to be an elder. I experienced sexual abuse at his hands. And along with that, I had four infant babies. 4 years, they died back to back, you know, in my arms. If that wasn't enough on my plate, my dad incurred lung cancer. And me being his primary caregiver, it was stressful and it took a huge toll on my life. And, you know, along with the drug abuse, along with the sexual abuse, along with the deaths, I just bared all that pain, and it caused me to just lose all concept of reality and everything. So I turned to drugs to fill that void, because I often asked myself, God, how can this man be in your image and do these kind of things to me? So my trust with God was gone, and then. Even when I told my mother about the situation, the abuser always had some excuse to validate his bad behavior.
Right.
You know, and so it's not that she didn't love me or that she didn't care about me. She didn't believe me because he covered up his own thing so well. He was a chameleon, you know. And being an elder, you know, at the time of era of life, people didn't really know about sexual abuse as much as it's exposed today. Doing that kind of thing, it was taboo at that time, you know. Today it's more open, and kids have a better chance of revealing, you know, those kind of things today, you know.
Well, I tell you this, I didn't see you, and I didn't know you were going having those type of experiences.
Yes, yes.
But I'm sure they created pain, as you mentioned, but why didn't you turn back to the Lord? I mean, why didn't you surrender to the Lord?
Well, it was hard because I didn't trust the God that if this guy is in God's image and he's doing this to people, he's putting pain, inflicting pain. Why would I want to serve a God like that? And then it caused me to have abandonment issues and trust issues, not only with God, but with my mother and women in general. It caused my relationships to be very damaging, destructive, because the trust level was gone, you know. Going through all the pain and everything and hitting what they call rock bottom, you know, losing everything, you come to realize that my life is unmanageable.
So when did you receive the Lord?
I received the Lord at an early age. However, I was a backslider.
Okay.
You know, I had left the umbrella of safety, protection, yeah. You know, from God. But probably within the last year or so is when I really have committed myself to God and have surrendered my will and care over to Him. You know, wholeheartedly, where I trust in Him today. I get out of the way and let Him do me today. I no longer say, I'm doing me. Right. Because when I was doing me, I learned that I didn't take it very well of myself. But God.
You became a criminal?
I became a dope fiend. See, God takes care of me better than I took care of myself because, for example, I smoked meth, and all the ingredients in meth, and even bath salt, it says fatal if ingested. But I was smoking it getting high. Look at the sanity in that thing. I mean, wow, you would really have to be, you know, insane to do something like that, you know. But I got high on that every day, you know. But thanks be to God, his mercy and grace has taken me away from that. And he's, you know, he's saved me and he's rescued me because not only that, during my drug addiction, I've had unprotected sex and I've been with women of all sorts, you know. Some of them I woke up didn't even know their name, you know, but that's the things that you go through. And again, I'm here to say that God has made a difference in my life today. You know, I have direction today. I have a purpose today.
So you got to rock bottom. You were in jail. You were in jail for how long?
Oh, close to 10 years.
10 years.
Yeah, and after that, they gave me post-release control. And by the grace of God, the parole board of Ohio released me within 1 year because I was doing what I needed to do in their eyes. And because God had lifted me up, because I had humbled myself before him, and he lifted me up. Because, you know, there's humility before there's honor. And without hitting rock bottom and knowing that the only way that I could even be somebody was with through God, you know, he took nothing and he's making nothing out of something.
Right, yeah. Right. Well, you found the Lord.
Yes.
As your Savior in jail.
We need to, jail and prison is two different things.
Okay.
You know, jail is very different from prison. At either rate, you're incarcerated and you lost your freedom. And losing your freedom is probably one of the biggest commodities that you don't want to lose. God has told me today I have a choice. And today I want to hold on to my choice. I don't want to give up my choice today.
Do you remember Jesse Jackson?
Yes.
Let me, if you would have met Jesse Jackson in 1988, he would have said to you, down with dope, up with hope. What's your reaction to that?
Well, I remember that saying very well back then. And at that time, Huey Lewis had a song called It's Hip to Be Square. And really that falls right in line with what Jesse Jackson is saying, because down with dope and up with hope. If we had hope today, that's the only thing that's preserving me today is hope, my hope in Jesus.
Your hope in who?
My hope in Jesus Christ, knowing that my life is guided by him. If I ask him to let me walk in his ways, let me hear in his ways, let me see, and let his words be my words, I find that I'm a lot better off than me trying to do it on my own today.
Now, you mentioned that you manufactured crack cocaine.
Yes.
Smokey Robinson said in 1989, weed does nothing but cloud your mind and make you think you are something you are not. That's what weed does.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can agree on that, but I've done a lot of drugs, and I don't think any drug clears your mind. I think it all clouds your mind and gives you a false perception of who you are. You know, I remember back in the day, they said Dr. Timothy Leary was stating that if you take acid, you know, you get closer to your higher power. You know, but a drug is a drug, and the ultimate end is addiction. And addiction is devastating. It breaks up families. You lose jobs. It breaks down your self-esteem. I mean, it breaks you down to nothing. And then your whole life is consumed with trying to get high. You know, it has a physical, mental, and spiritual toll on you.
Can you relate to Quincy Jones in 1987? He says, the most deadly thing about cocaine is that it separates you from your soul.
Wow. Again, I think all the drugs separate you from your soul, because your whole life becomes consumed with the high. Whether it's alcoholism, whether it's drug addiction, whether it's gambling, whether it's sexual addiction. Addiction is very prevalent in our society today, and it has a toll. It's taking a toll on our society's fiber. It's breaking down the morals and values of families. You know, just the other day, I experienced seeing a youth doing something wrong, and an elderly person says, "Hey, young blood, don't do that." And there was no respect at all. The guy told the older guy, "You know, you do this here, blah, 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 and I'll do this to you." And I remember growing up, we didn't speak back to our elders. You know, we respected what they said, and, you know, we went on our way. But that just goes to show you how society's fiber has deteriorated, you know, because of drugs. You know, today you hear people say, I would rather for my kid to get high with me or to get high at home. But, you know, little do they know that is a prescription for disaster. Right. You know, to do that, you know, it's just permitting drug abuse, and I don't think that's real prevalent today.
Richard Pryor say, 1986, self-pity is a drug.
Ooh, yes indeed. Yeah, you can't have a pity party. We have choices today, you know, and if you choose to use, that is your choice. I choose not to use today. Again, like I said, I'd rather have a choice. And I'd rather keep that choice. And if I give up that choice, then I don't have any power anymore.
Right. Well, let me ask you, let me say one more thing here. Dorothy Riley in 1984, in the family reunion, she says, "Blood may be thicker than water, but it is not thicker than crack cocaine."
Lord have mercy, did she say a mouthful there. You know, that reminds me of, you know, the blood in speaking, and speaking of my mother, I was going through a feeding state at this time, and I remember robbing my own mother.
What'd you say?
I robbed my own mother, you know, to get high, to get money to get high. So. Yeah, that cocaine was thicker than the bloodline, because I wanted that hit, and by any means necessary. You know, I was a true addict. I didn't play at my addiction. You know, I got high, you know, and today I fiend on Jesus.
What'd you say?
I fiend on Jesus today, and, you know, I every time the doors are open to the church, I'm in there. I'm running in there, you know, whether it's rain, sleet, or snow. You know, that's what I did for my drug. I don't care if it was a snowstorm and I wanted to get high. I was out there trying to find a dope man. You know what I mean? So I try to find Jesus all day long. Everything I do, I try to find him in it, you know.
Well, let me ask you this. Do you think marijuana should be accepted and be used as a medicine?
I believe that it does have some medical properties, but again, a drug is a drug to me, and I'm clean and sober today because of Jesus Christ. And I can't condone one getting high, no matter if it does have properties, because if you look at pain medications, they also have medical properties that help people, but people are being addicted to those things. So if I'm going to compare a drug, the only drug I can compare would be Jesus, and to use Jesus Christ as your drug, you know, because the Word of God in the Bible, it tells us how he healed and how he made the blind see, and he brought the dead alive, and the cripple, you know, he healed those guys. I mean, if he has those kind of powers and abilities, certainly he could compensate for that feeling that you're missing, that void that you're missing, you're trying to use with drugs. You know, and that's all drugs does. Drugs is just a temporary fix. But Jesus is a long-term fix. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, you know.
So the scripture says, let wine, little wine for the stomach's sake, little marijuana for the head's sake.
Well, I don't remember seeing a little marijuana in the word, but, you know, a person that has given up using drugs, I can't condone any drugs. I can only tell you what God has done in my life.
And, now, some circles in the church, they drink a little wine for communion, for the stomach's sake.
My life, I look at the log in my eye. And if I can take the log out of my eye and ask God to help me, help my light shine and help the difference in the change in me, inspire someone else to do better, that's the only way I can go. Because I can't judge, because if I judge, I'll be judged. But if God takes those things that are negative out of my life, and someone can see the difference in my life and see the change in me, hopefully it will inspire them and encourage them that maybe they can do the same with their life. And that's the only way I can only go according to what the Word of God says. I don't try to interpret it. I don't try to add to it. I don't try to take away from it. I read it as, and I accept it as what it is.
Well, it does say, be not drunk with wine. So be not high with cocaine. And this type of thing is destroying the world.
Yes.
Drugs. We're going to, there's a problem.
There's a problem.
State representatives, the senators, the governor are doing everything they can to solve that problem.
Yes.
And they have given the constituents of Pennsylvania an anti-drug song. Let's listen to that anti-drug song.
Someone to understand. Oh yes, we are the people who need a helping hand. We are the family. Strength to stand. We are the children who need a helping hand. Someone to understand. Oh yes, you have blessed us with mountains and valleys to reveal to us your majesty and power. Oh, you can see, oh God, we expect to give us a helping hand. You have granted us with the golden eagle bird, and we are so delighted. Oh, you can see, oh God, without
Again, I thank God for allowing John Fletcher and raising John Fletcher for such a time as this. We're going to listen to one of his writings. He is an established poet. We'd like to hear from you today.
Since today is Valentine's Day and I love Jesus, I wrote him a letter, and it's called To Jesus, My Boo. Jesus, I love you and want to make this very clear. You are always on my mind, a gift from the heavens by way of your Father God, that I hold very dear to worship and praise your name. Jesus, I'm writing this just for you. Jesus, it is your love that gets me through. Jesus, as you know, there are so many things going on in my life, but you are my foremost, the biggest and most important part. Jesus, your joy, your patience, your goodness, your faithfulness, and your loving kindness allows the passion and love I have for you can truly only come from the bottom of my heart. And Jesus, you remind me so often that in order to see a rainbow, I must first go through the storm and rain. And Jesus, you are true love which helps me. It endures the little pain. And after the rain, Jesus, I become your precious flower. And this is the confidence that I have in you that gives me power. As long as I have you, Jesus, in my heart and on my mind, I know that as I walk by faith and not by sight, things will be just fine. So Jesus, I will always remember you are a blessing that shines and shows my very existence. Jesus, you are on my heart and mind daily with a welcome persistence. 381 for life. To Jesus Christ, my boo. Three words, eight letters, one meaning. I love you.
We thank you for that beautiful Valentine's poem. And we thank you for sharing your experience with us today. My prayer for America is that God give you eyes to see the light of Jesus, ears to hear the voice of Jesus, heart to believe that God raised Jesus from the dead, and I shall be saved. God bless your bones, America.